You may have seen a TV show which was looking at professional sports and professional footballers and the way they consider their mental health, featuring the likes of Gareth Southgate, the England manager, Spurs defender Danny Rose, Peter Crouch, who is currently playing on, I think he's still at Burnley, and Prince William. It was hosted by Dan Walker, and it's been really interesting to hear some of the fallout from that conversation and the content of that conversation as well. Really quite something. Danny Rose, for instance, who felt, you know, powerful enough and empowered enough to have a conversation about mental health, but actually found himself in a situation where clubs who wanted to sign him were kind of going, can we suss him out because we want to find out if he's crazy or not? You know, these sorts of things still very much going on within the world. And that's, you know, despite employment law and everything else that falls into it. We're going to have this conversation now with somebody who's right at the centre of research when it comes to professional athletes, but those athletes at all different levels of sport. His name is Andy Smith from Edgehill University, and he joins on the programme. Andy, thank you for your time. Great to see you.
Oh, good afternoon, Mick.
You looked at a range of people from a range of different sports, range of different backgrounds as well. What was your, is it cohort? Is that the phrase that we use?
Yeah, or sample. We spoke to over 1,200 people aged 16 and above from over 50 sports and activities, including football, netball, as well as the more individual activities like going to the gym and people who might exercise at the formal team setting.
So in terms of your headline findings, did you have like a, something you were looking to find? Was there something where you thought, we think there's a story here that's untold?
We've been researching and teaching this area now for many years, but what always struck us really when we were talking to people is we don't really know how big of an issue, in inverted commas, mental health and illness is across this full spectrum of sport, from your volunteering on a Tuesday afternoon all the way through to your professional sports people like the guys that you mentioned earlier. So we didn't really set out with any preconceived ideas. We wanted really to find out what the state of play was. And when we did that, we unearthed a number of interesting things. We found overall 57% of the people who we surveyed had ever experienced mental illness like depression, anxiety, panic disorders and a whole range of other things. And of those, 40% currently do. And what was also particularly interesting within that was that over 70% of women aged 16 to 24 had ever experienced mental illness, and over half of them currently did. Whereas for men, we found that they were much more likely to have a mental illness like anxiety, depression and so on from the age of 35.
So if you compare that to sort of the nationally assumed stats based on previous research, the numbers you're looking at there are significantly higher than the national average or the perceived national average at the moment, which raises the question, what's going on in sport or what's going on with the other national stats that's created such a difference? How big is that difference?
It's quite widely reported that around 1 in 4 people in society will experience a mental illness, and there's still some debate over that. But what is very clear that if we took our sample overall and excluded people who also had current mental illness as well as having mental illness in the past, we would still arrive at around 1 in 4. But what we're particularly interested in, and what the findings reveal, was that if we move beyond that, we're actually finding a particular set of issues for different groups of people who work in sport. So this won't just be a sport and mental health problem. You alluded earlier to the blue light services, where there are quite high rates of illness. But what we're particularly interested in is the full diversity within sport. And there are different patterns within them. So the people are at different risk, depending on what groups that you look at.
So in terms of sport itself, always perceived to be a positive thing, isn't it, for mental health? So are people who might be prone to certain mental illnesses, are they prone to take part in certain sports? Is there a cause and effect, or is there something about people who have, you know, supreme physical prowess maybe that might take them down a different path?
In some cases, not surprisingly, the answer to that question is quite complicated, and quite complex depending on what sports you look at and what levels of sport you look at. What we found was clearly a mixed picture for some people who responded to our research. Commented very positively about the ways in which they use sport, exercise and other ways of being active to relieve stress, manage experiences of anxiety, depression, to prevent mental illness in the first place, but also to give them a sense of meaning and identity. For others, including people who may work in quite isolated job roles, that might be a coach or a volunteer, administrator, sport or athlete, for them, competing in sports was quite a negative had a quite a negative impact on mental health. So it's not so much that people playing particular types of sports or activities are more or less likely. You just what we do find is that for some people it can be quite a positive thing, but for others, the conditions of work, the environments within which they operate, can have a real red flag for mental health.
So although people might be going, "Oh, I'm involved in grassroots sport," that's great. Actually, that might involve washing 38 football kits twice a week, and the pressures that come with that, as well as holding down a job and the travel that comes with that, and maybe even the pressure that comes with that.
Absolutely. We wanted to represent much more clearly than previously in this study those types of groups of people who played sport. And one of the major conclusions of the work is that actually mental health in grassroots sport is quite a significant public health problem. You've already mentioned people who might be doing a lot of this stuff for free. They're also holding down part-time or full-time work. And it can be quite pressurised, particularly people who are under pressure for example, generating funding to keep clubs or teams or individuals going. And you're seeing that across the entire charity sector as well. So everyone is at significant risk, potentially, of poor mental health. But in others, we're finding that they're able to manage those pressures positively to improve mental health.
Because that's quite something, isn't it, that people who essentially facilitate sport for other people who might be able to go out and enjoy it and see it as a huge benefit are actually having a negative relationship, if you like, with the sport.
Indeed, there's quite a lot of evidence which points, for example, to volunteering and the benefits of volunteering to positive mental health and well-being. And that's true, not just of sport, but in lots of other areas, including the arts, volunteering, walking and so on. But what we also see is that if you're volunteering and you're supporting the infrastructure of sport and someone comes to you, for example, with a particular mental health challenge or difficulty, or you yourself are experiencing mental illness, that could also put you at particular risk, especially when there might be little mental health support for the organisation that you're working for, particularly if you're working in quite isolated areas or on your own or with a very few people. And for some people, that might be offset by very positive working relationships with people who run sport. For others who spoke to us, that support was less favourable, and the support seemed to be lacking among some of the senior leaders in sport.
We've got Professor Andy Smith with us from Edgehill University. His new report is looking at the impact of mental health around sport and how different people have different perspectives. I was going to ask you about team sports versus individual sports, because if you ever hear about tennis players, for instance, who have this slightly lonely existence and play in far-flung places, often for very little or no money, they face a whole heap of different pressure from sponsors, often from people who maybe gamble on these events and send all kinds of different abuse. What did you see in terms of the team sports versus the individuals?
Yeah, I mean, I think you mentioned around loneliness and pressure and so on. It might seem a little contradictory to talk about loneliness in team settings, but I think as the conversations last night revealed, particularly in the context of football, there is not only always a culture of silence around mental health and illness, but also a culture of loneliness, was a lack of willingness or feeling able to discuss your mental health challenges with other people with whom you work. Just to give you a sense of some of the sports, that the sport that we had the highest number of respondents from our survey was football. We had 234 respondents to the survey, and of those, around 52% had ever experienced mental illness, and around 40% currently experienced mental illness. If we compare that, for example, to things like cricket, 40% and 60% respectively. But even in sports like swimming, for example, we're seeing slightly more people currently experiencing illness, 57%. But for those who currently experience it, it's the same proportion as team sports. So we're not actually seeing a substantial difference. If we take running by contrast, just over a quarter of people who responded to us have currently experienced mental illness. So it's not always necessarily the types of activities or sports. It might be the particular cultures which are evident within those organisations. That is key.
So Gareth Southgate was involved in the programme that was aired on the TV last night. Prince William, part of the royal family, as an institution in its own regard as well. In terms of the research, how key is that sort of framework and infrastructure In terms of how people are able to respond. Because if we talk about volunteers, if they're kind of the last line, first and last line of defence, if you like, the pressures that come with that as well. But if you're part of a professional club network with things that are taken seriously, both physical and mentally, presumably you're in a much better place. Is that something that was reflected?
Yeah, I think without question, it was clear that those respondents who felt that mental health was seen as a priority by their managers or the leaders of their organisations were much more likely to comment positively on the ways in which cases of mental illness may be treated, where there's a willingness and a culture of openness to discuss the challenges that you face, whether individually, collectively, or whether it's somebody whom you know outside of work. But we also found a lot of cases where some of those respondents didn't feel willing or capable or supported when they did come out. A number of people, and we often use this phrase as coming out, which is quite stigmatising in itself, actually, in some cases. And what we found for those people who didn't perceive their organisations to be quite supportive was a real reluctance to disclose at work. Sometimes there was a lack of willingness to acknowledge that there were challenges being experienced. And in other cases, people often concealed their mental illness from their employers for fear of being stigmatised and so on, and perhaps even being given more responsibility and higher workloads almost as a means of punishment. And that's how a few people, not many, but how some people regarded mental health in the workplace.
In terms of people who get involved in sport, that dressing room culture, the negative connotations that we know, the manning up, the macho, the wall of silence, don't talk about how you feel, it's all about, you know, winning on the pitch or wherever it is. Did that kind of come up? Was that still reflected? Is that still a prominent attitude that's out there?
Again, I think it varies by level of sport. We have data both for professional and community settings. At the professional level, it's certainly true that a number of response both to this project but also other research that we've been involved in, there is still that culture of fear and silence and a lack of willingness to discuss. And the fact that we're in 2019 talking about the programme that you referred to last night, almost as if it's quite stand out and it's quite unique, is an indicator of how far we've come, but also how far we have to go. A number of people would often talk about the ways in which they didn't feel able to be who they really were at work, and they weren't able to say what they wanted to say or to act in particular ways. And really that fit, that lack of authenticity, if you like, genuineness about who you are and what you are, had a big impact on their mental health and wellbeing.
And in terms of that, I mean, it's really interesting, you know, let people be the people that they are, and then, you know, respect them for that no matter how they come. But at the same time, if we're looking about professional sports or sport at different levels, performance will always be at the heart of it. Are there any conclusions you can draw between those who have a certain mindset or mental wellness or illness versus their level of performance and sustained performance over a longer period of time?
Again, for some people who may experience a range of mental health challenges, they're able to perform at the highest level and to perform consistently well. And some of that high-performing element can be very positive for those guys, and they can withstand, be resilient, if you like, which is the popular term, and perform very well at the highest level. For others, that performance may mean that they're not mentally well or not willing to engage in conversations that they're mentally well, and that essentially all builds up, snowballs, if you like, into a situation where their mental health deteriorates quite rapidly thereafter. But in other cases, it's true that some of the very confident, very highly individualized, very committed people, in the physical sense, if you like, are also among those who may be mentally vulnerable, but also appear to have a degree of resilience to perform and succeed at the highest level.
Often sort of leadership is key on this one. If you were part of a team, then you're looking up to your coaches. You actually found that number of coaches who are suffering mental ill health is still pretty significant as well. Did they seem open to having that conversation as those who were involved in the actual coaching?
Again, a mixed picture. For some, they felt confident about having conversations around mental health. They themselves, some of the coaches who responded to us, regarded themselves as important role models and were very keen to make clear to others that they themselves had experienced a variety of mental health challenges. And that was often seen to be a positive thing, as an important sign of leadership. For others, they were much less confident around disclosing their own mental health or mental illness because of the ways in which they may have been perceived by their employers, in inverted commas, and sometimes by their athletes. And we find that again at both the performance professional level of sport, but also in more community settings.
What's the value of this information now we've got it? So you show up, the prof rocks up with his laptop, he's got the information. Sports comes right, well, we seem to be doing all right with the setup that we've got. Although that provision and the humanity of it, of recognising that these people may have these issues potentially now or in the future, and those sports clubs are kind of, well, they're places that people connect, can't they? On a twice, three, four times a week as well. So for a lot of people, it can be maybe the centre of their social life as much as anything.
Absolutely. And I think the importance of this work and any work should also always be in how it supports people on the ground. What's its practical relevance? I think hopefully we've identified a number of things. There's some clear areas of good positive practice that goes on in the world of sport and activity broadly defined, and that needs to be continued and continue to be strengthened. But we've also identified, as in other aspects of society, areas where we need to continue to improve, and that might be around educating people around mental health and what it is and what it isn't, about identifying the different types of signs and symptoms, but also about positive recovery and that people can and should be supported. And one of the key things is really how do we help the workforce, whether they're paid members of very established professional sports or unpaid volunteers who do so for the love of their individual sports or organisations, can be supported generally, not just in relation to their mental health, but also to ensure that mental health becomes a responsibility of everyone and not just as an add-on or not something which is sometimes raised during Mental Health Awareness Week and we move on to the next.
Exactly. You were working alongside the DOCIA sports organisation. Yeah. Is there a sense that maybe governing bodies might be open to having these conversations, that you could go to Cyclists Association, that you could go to the British Boxing Border Control if you wanted to, and go, this is the evidence of what's happening in your sport, and these are the experiences that people are having. So if it came from on high, that openness might be something that they'd be educated on, first and foremost, and then secondly, able to act upon.
Absolutely. And I think when we originally circulated the survey and then when we began to analyse the results, we received a number of positive responses from national governing bodies in the UK, as well as some more of the local organisations who are very enthusiastic and committed to trying to raise understanding and awareness of this issue and also to try to work with us on how we could best support them to help other people. And it was significant that we managed to recruit a number of chief executive officers from a lot of those national governing bodies to respond to the survey and how they can circulate that among their employees. Others were perhaps more concerned about what their findings might show, which is not unsurprising and understandable at one level. But it's certainly true that the response from some of these sporting organisations since we first published the headlines of these have been very positive indeed.
You're doing a lot of really interesting work, Andy, through Edgehill University. You're working with different charities as well. What's next in terms of the work you're doing at the moment from a mental health point of view?
Well, we finished the first stage of the project that we've been talking about, and really encouragingly for us, as well as the number of respondents to the survey, we've also had over 400 people who responded to the survey wanting to speak to us via interviews and through other means. So we're beginning to start making our way through that. So that's the next stage, really, to begin to understand some of the things in a bit more detail that we've discussed today. But also what we're also beginning to do on the ground is starting to use some of the work that is done by the excellent charities, particularly those in Merseyside, and how that can be used to inform sport physical activity generally. Obviously, you'll be familiar with Jake Mills and Chasing the Stigma, the National Mental Health Charity, and their Hub of Hope. We're already seeing people use the Hub of Hope out in the sector. So if they're working individually as volunteers or coaches, when someone presents to them, where do I refer my mental health, this person, to a particular mental health service, they're already actively using the Hub of Hope to direct people. And we're also seeing through our work with Everton that we've been doing for over 6 years, a number of people trying to access those services even more, to connect people locally into some of the broader national services, but also to make a real difference to people's lives.
Andy, thank you for your time today. Thanks for coming in. Look forward to hearing some more about the work you're doing. Andy Smith, Professor Andy Smith from Edgehill University. And that show, I think, is available still on the iPlayer. And I'm sure you'll be seeing some more clips of it as well in regard to Prince William, Gareth Southgate, among others. It's Radio City Talk.